In the bulb there is a flower, in the seed an apple tree, in cocoons a hidden promise, butterflies will soon be free. In the cold and snow of winter, there's a spring that waits to be unrevealed until its season. Something got along.
Greetings and welcome to this, our service from Trinity United Methodist Church. We come to you recording this really on Thursday, which some of you probably have noted was supposed to be opening day for the baseball season. Another indication of how it is that we are all very much involved in countering the spread of this coronavirus. We, however, in the midst of all that, continue to worship our God whose strength, whose power, whose love is over all and in all. And so we come today to give praise to God, to ask the Lord's presence to be with us, that we may, in His Word, find that strength, that help, and that perspective that we need to find ourselves through this day and through the days that are ahead. So welcome, and let us enter into, wherever you may be, enter into this service of worship, giving praise to God, hear His Word, pray to His grace and mercy, and let His love flow into our lives. Listen now as Michelle shares with us a greeting and the announcements of the day.
Good morning. We will continue keeping you in our prayers. We have canceled all the committee meetings scheduled for April. Carolyn Jenkins from the UMW asked me to pass along that the UMW meeting for April is canceled and the family dinner scheduled for May has been canceled. There will be no worship services in April. This includes Palm Sunday, Easter, and the Holy Week services. We will still have the Easter flowers delivered, and we will set up pickup from the parking lot on Saturday, April 11th from 10 till noon. And I will contact those of you who have ordered flowers to set this up. I'll bring them to your car and you don't have to get out. And if you can't pick up your flowers, please let me know and I'll arrange to bring them to your house. Just so you know, Pastor Dave, John, and I will continue to record a service as long as we are able. Please look for an announcement when each week's video is posted. If you have a loved one who doesn't have internet service, please try to play the service over the phone by holding your phone up to your computer or tablet and let them hear it at least. Continue to communicate your concerns to the church office on the office phone. Peggy Papish is working from home and can access the messages remotely. You can also use email to communicate your concerns. And Peggy did come into the office one day to mail the weekly newsletter to those without email. Remember, we are here for you. And please stay safe. And pass that peace of Christ to one another in your homes.
This is the day, this is the day that the Lord has made, that the Lord has made. I will rejoice and be glad in it, and be glad in it. This is the day that the Lord has made, I will rejoice and be glad in it. This is the day that the Lord has made. I will rejoice and be glad in it, and be glad in it. This is the day that the Lord has made, I will rejoice and be glad in it. This is the day that the Lord has made. rejoice and be glad in it, and be glad in it. This is the day that the Lord has made. I will rejoice and be glad in it. This is the day that the Lord has made.
Our call to worship this morning is from Psalm 130. Out of the depths I cry to you, O Lord. Lord, hear my voice. Let your ears be attentive to the voice of my supplications. If you, O Lord, should mark iniquities, Lord, who could I stand? But there is forgiveness with you, so that you may be revered. I wait for the Lord, my soul waits, and in his word I hope. My soul waits for the Lord, more than those who watch for the morning. More than those who watch for the morning. O Israel, I hope in the Lord, for the Lord is there is steadfast love, and with him is great power to redeem. It is he who will redeem Israel from all its iniquities. Amen.
Let's take this time, as we do in our service every Sunday when we're gathered here, to be in prayer for each other. Let us, if you would, just take a moment now to recall how it is to sit among one another and to feel each other's presence here, and to let our prayers settle on each of them, on each of us, on each of those who share worship together. Let us just for a moment linger over each person and say, Lord, peace, grace, and mercy be upon you. And then let us remember how it is that person from person will speak and say a word about someone whom they know that needs a prayer. And let us know that those prayers are still being raised up from those individuals. And let us say again, Lord, hear our prayer. Lord, hear her prayer. Lord, hear his prayer. Lord, hear our prayer. And let us bow and look to the Lord in our prayer together. Gracious God, this day, let your light shine upon us. Gracious God, this day, remove the darkness, and for just these moments, let us see your light. And then, Lord, let that light live in us and around us through the remaining of this day and in the days that are ahead. For, Lord, you are our light. For, Lord, you are our life. And we look to you in our prayers today. We give you thanks, Lord, that by your grace and by your goodness we rose this morning. While it is we may be confined to our homes as much as possible, we nevertheless have our life. We are moving about, and we thank you for that. We pray you will nurture us in this day. We pray that you will guard, guide, and protect us in this day and our families. We look to you, Lord, for those who must work this day. We particularly look to you for those who serve others in this day. Someone said this is the year of the nurses, for they are the ones that are bringing healing and strength and help to those who are sick and ill and in our hospitals. We pray you be with them. We pray you be with all who are bringing service to others, those who are serving meals, those who are restraining crowds, those who are just seeking to deliver needed goods to one another, whether by their job or by their heart, that, Lord, it may be your presence surrounds them, protects them, and brings not only that service that they bring, but also the love with which it is sent. And we pray your protection to be upon us. Bless us, O Lord, and those throughout our world, as we are one now. We are one. Under a cloud of disease, but Lord, all looking to you in prayer, be thou our strength, be thou our help, be thou our God. In Jesus' name we pray, and as he so lovingly taught us, we say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever.
Danced in the morning when the world was begun, and I danced in the moon and the stars and the sun. And I came down from heaven and I danced on the earth. At Bethlehem I had my birth. So dance, dance wherever you may be. I am the Lord of the dance at thee. And I lead you all wherever you may be, and I lead you all in the dance at me. I danced for the scribe and the Pharisee, They would not dance and they would not follow me. And I danced for the fishermen, for James and John. They came to me and the dance went on. So dance, dance, wherever you may be. I am the Lord of the dance, said he. And I lead you all, wherever you may be. And I lead you all in the dance, said he. I danced on the Sabbath when I cured the lame. The holy people said it was a shame. They whipped and they stripped me and they hung me high. They left me there on a cross to die. Dance, dance, wherever you may be. I am the Lord of the dance, said he. And I lead you all, wherever you may be. And I lead you all in the dance, said he. I danced on a Friday when the sky turned black. It's hard to dance with the devil on your back. They buried my body and they thought I'd gone. But I am the dance and I still go on. Dance, dance, wherever you may be. I am the Lord of the dance, said he. And I lead you all, wherever you may be. And I lead you all in the dance, said he. Down and I leapt up high. I am the life that'll never, never die. I live in you if you live in me. I am the Lord of the dance, said he. Dance, dance, wherever you may be. I am the Lord of the dance, said he. And I lead you all, wherever you may be. And I lead you all in the dance, said he. Dance!
Pray with me. Open our hearts and minds, dear Lord, to hear the lessons you have for us in the reading of your word. Through Jesus Christ's holy name, amen. I will read from John chapter 11, verses 1 through 7 and 17 to 44. Now a certain man was ill, Lazarus of Bethany, the village of Mary and her sister Martha. Mary was the one who anointed the Lord with perfume and wiped his feet with her hair. Her brother Lazarus was ill. So the sisters sent a message to Jesus. Lord, he whom you love is ill. But when Jesus heard it, he said, this illness does not lead to death. Rather, it is for God's glory, so that the Son of God may be glorified through it. Accordingly, though Jesus loved Martha and her sister and Lazarus, after having heard that Lazarus was ill, he stayed 2 days longer in the place where he was. And after this, he said to his disciples, let us go to Judea again. The disciples said to him, Rabbi, the Jews were just now trying to stone you, and you're going there again? Jesus answered, are there not 12 hours daylight? Those who walk during the day do not stumble because they see the light of this world. But those who walk at night stumble because the light is not in them. After saying this, he told them, our friend Lazarus has fallen asleep, but I am going there to awaken him. When Jesus arrived, he found that Lazarus had already been in the tomb 4 days. Now Bethany was near Jerusalem, some 2 miles away, and many of the Jews had come to Martha and Mary to console them about their brother. When Martha heard that Jesus was coming, he went and met them, while Mary stayed at home. Martha said to Jesus, Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. But even now, I know that God will give you whatever you ask of him. Jesus said to her, "Your brother will rise again." Martha said to him, "I know that he will rise again in the resurrection on the last day." And Jesus said to her, "I am the resurrection and the life. Those who believe in me, even though they die, will live. And everyone who lives and believes in me will never die. Do you believe this?" She said to him, "Yes, Lord, I believe that you are the Messiah, the Son of God, the one coming into the world." When she had said this, she went back and called her sister Mary and told her privately, "The teacher is here and is calling for you." And when she heard it, she got up quickly and went to him. And now Jesus had not yet come to the village, but was still in the place where Martha had met him. And the Jews who were with her in the house consoling her saw Mary get up quickly and go out. They followed her because they thought that she was going to the tomb to weep there. When Mary came where Jesus was and saw him, she knelt at his feet and said to him, "Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died." When Jesus saw her weeping, and the Jews who came with her also weeping, he was greatly disturbed in spirit and deeply moved. He said, "Where have you laid him?" They said to him, "Lord, come and see." Jesus began to weep. So the Jews said, "See how he loved him?" But some of them said, "Could he not, he who opened the eyes of the blind man, have kept this man from dying?" Then Jesus, again greatly disturbed, came to the tomb. It was a cave, and a stone was lying against it. Jesus said, "Take away the stone." Martha, the sister of the dead man, said to him, "Lord, already there is a stench because he has been there 4 days. Jesus said to her, "Did I not tell you that if you believed, you would see the glory of God?" So they took away the stone, and Jesus looked upward and said, "Father, I thank you for having heard me. I knew that you always hear me, but I have said this for the sake of the crowd standing here, so they may believe that you sent me." When he said this, he cried with a loud voice, "Lazarus, come out!" The dead man came out, his hands and feet bound with strips of cloth, and his face wrapped in a cloth. Jesus said to them, "Unbind him and let him go." And this is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. I hope that as you get opportunity, you might read that 11th chapter of John's Gospel where this story is found. It's a long story. I thank Michelle for reading our way through. We left out some verses where Jesus was trying to interpret to his disciples the difference between sleeping, dying, and having new life, and then portraying with others the difference between getting Lazarus out of the tomb, but then later on, him offering resurrection to all. It's an exciting, multi-level story. And it would be well worth your poring over it as you get opportunity at home. Oh, and you will have opportunity, right? Because what else is there to do? But take a moment and read through this story. I would remind you, it comes from the Gospel of John. And John is just one of the most exciting Gospels because he has such a wonderful premise for us. You know how it begins back in the first chapter? It starts just like Genesis, because what John is saying, Jesus is bringing in a new world, so he sounds like creation. He says, "In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God, and all things came into being through him. And without him, not one thing came into being. What has come into being in him was life. And the life was the light of all people. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness did not overcome it." So then John loves telling these stories where these truths are made plain through the actions of Jesus. And this story about Lazarus is really kind of like the best of them all. Matter of fact, it's the last of those miracle stories that John tells, because right after this, he begins telling the story of the passion of Jesus, that is his arrest, trial, crucifixion, and resurrection. That's the rest of John's book from here. And so this is the climax of the stories that Jesus tells, because, as someone points out in the course of the reading, one of the Jews was saying, well, we know that he gave sight to the blind, but this is something different. This is somebody who is not blind. This is somebody who is dead. Can Jesus do anything for him at all? And we would ask the same question, would we not? I mean, there's some kind of similarity. I know it's a stretch, but come on, that's what preachers do, is stretch. So stretch with me a little bit. There's some kind of similarity between Lazarus confined in the tomb with the stone rolled in front of it. There's a similarity to that in Jesus, for sure. But there's also a similarity to that in us, right? Because we are locked in our homes, not locked, but sealed. And we're asked to stay there, can't come out, just stay there. And I don't know how it is with you in your home, but that becomes a very, very familiar surrounding after a while. And as much as I try to turn on all the lights, it gets dark in there. You know, and you think, oh, gee, it sure would be glad to get out of here. And I wonder whether the love of God can reach into here. So here's the issue. In the most extreme of all circumstances, nobody has ever seen anything like this before. In the most extreme of all circumstances, can God do anything for us? I want to say just real quickly, I don't want to take a lot of your time, but there's at least four things we ought to draw out of this story of the raising of Lazarus from the dead. And the first one is this, is that God is always reaching out to us in love. So the story begins with message coming. Somebody prayed. The message is coming to Jesus that Lazarus, whom he loves, and it's interesting that they call him Lazarus, whom he loves, because is there a Lazarus around that he doesn't love? And it's just kind of like saying, look, Jesus, we're all joined to you in love. And we could say that in our prayers too, couldn't we? Jesus, this one who is joined to you in love. That's good. Remind Jesus of that. You know, we have this connection with you, Lord. Jesus, this one whom you love, named Lazarus, is sick, and he's very sick. And Jesus responds to that by coming to Bethany. Oh, but you'll say, oh, but he didn't come right away. No, and that is because Jesus works out of a different framework of time than the rest of us. The rest of us would have him try to get there in the next 3 hours or call 911 again. But Jesus works not out of a calendar time, a clock time, a watch time, but Jesus works out of a viewpoint of eternity, out of the time of the purposes of God to unfold. And there was something special that Jesus wanted people to see. But nevertheless, he came to Bethany. He comes to Catonsville. He comes to Owella. He comes to Arbutus. He comes to wherever you are, because you are the one that he loves. Now, the second thing that we want to see in the midst of all this is that Jesus has a deep, deep concern for those to whom he comes. Because it doesn't just say that Jesus sympathizes with them. It says that Jesus wept for him. And then the word that's used for wept is just a deep, deep emotion. I ache for you. I pain for you. It's like the tears that Jesus cried in Gethsemane, struggling with God for his coming crucifixion, and that same kind of struggle he enters into Lazarus' pain, into Mary and Martha's pain, into the disciples' pain, into our pain. He weeps with us. He weeps with us in our situations, in our fear. He weeps in our isolation. He weeps and in the great travail of people who are suffering deeply at this time, for those who are sick and in the hospital, for those who have lost their jobs, for those who have lost any means of response to this virus. Jesus weeps with them. Third, Jesus, with the power of God's love in him, has this unrelenting, never defeated power to deal with any situation. And he comes into this situation, by the time he gets there, Lazarus is not only dead, but is in the tomb for 4 days, and finds there the most extreme of all difficulties, and those around him are questioning Jesus. Questioning, can he really do anything about this? This thing is so big, is there anything Jesus can do about this? And they do what we all do. He should have been here earlier. Isn't that something, to second guess Jesus? But that's what he should have been here earlier. You could have prevented this. And others said, well, you know, he did heal the blind. He gave the blind man sight, opened his eyes. Maybe there's something he could have done to have prevented this. But let's remember the prayer of Jesus. Remember the phrase, it's in the Lord's Prayer, and lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Jesus can't always prevent the evil, but he can deliver us from it. Oh, there's some evil that catches up with us, but Jesus can deliver us from it by that undeniable, unrelenting, never defeated power of God's love. And he comes to bring that. It's interesting how he does that. He does that with tears, but then he does that with a shout, a loud shout, an enormous shout heard all across the territory. Lazarus, come out. The whole county heard Jesus say, Lazarus, come out. Because the whole county knew that Lazarus was in the tomb. And everybody heard. And out he comes. In a very interesting way, because the scripture says, you read it, the scripture says he comes out bound head to foot. How does a person walk if he's bound head to foot, comes out with the gravecloth still over his head? How does he know how to get out when there's still the grave? We don't know. It's mysterious, and it's miraculous, and it's wonderful, because nobody knew how Jesus was going to do this. See, they could not imagine in their limited minds how Jesus was going to do this. We cannot even imagine right now how we're going to get out of all this situation that we're in. Amen? We don't know how we're going to manage our way through it. All I know is I'm going to take care of today and the next day. And then tomorrow I'm going to take care of that day and the day after that. And we, with God's help, will find our way through. And even like the one who was bound in the grave clothes and his head covered will still find a way out. Why? Because Jesus is calling us. Come out. Come out. Come out. Fourth thing I want you to know is that it all ends with the glory of God. Life does not end with misery, right? We are not locked into an entombment. Life ends, culminates, leads toward the glory of God. Because before and in the midst of what Jesus does he do? He says he lifts up his head and prays to God, Father, Father, I do this, he says, so that all can see your glory. And so we all might believe that Jesus is sent by God to show us God's glory. I think that's an indication for how we should pray. I think we should pray aloud. I really do. I mean, if Jesus prayed aloud, it's not. And besides, look, you're probably in the house by yourself, or maybe there's only a couple other people around. Nobody's going to care what you do. So just go ahead and pray aloud. Father, I just want to let you know that I know you hear me. I want to let you know that I feel your presence near me. I want to let you know that I need so much your love and care. I want you to know that I need you to show me how I can act in mercy and kindness to others, even while we're separated. Lord, I want you to know that my prayers go out for all, that let your prayers be heard loud into the air, into the sky, into the heart of God, that the Lord may hear us and the Lord responds. Jesus' love is real and powerful. We remember what Jesus has done before. Just like the guy said, well, heal the blind, Can he do anything here? We'll remember what Jesus has done for us in other times and other spaces, but now by this story, we will know that there's much he can do for us here, filling our lives with his presence and with his love. And we will know that we are bound not for misery, but we are bound for glory, because Jesus moves from this scene in this little village of Bethany to a bigger city called Jerusalem, to a bigger fate called crucifixion, and to a greater glory called the resurrection. And so do we as we follow him in our meditation, in our thoughts, and in our faith and hope and love of him today. Let's pray. Lord, we thank you for the wonderful stories that John tells. We thank you more for the wonderful deeds that Jesus did. And may they just pound into our hearts the wonder of your love, the glory of your goodness, and the everlasting power of your mercy. Bound for glory, Lord. Bound for glory. In Jesus' name. Amen.
Now I'll share with you our Apostles' Creed, the traditional version. I know you know it. Say it along with me. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Now you know, regularly in our service at this point that we take the offering. Obviously, there's no way we can pass the plate through the internet in order to get that to you. But we can remind you that a part of our worship with God every week is to give ourselves to God in our offering and to support the work of our church through our offering, our dedicated tithes. And so I would ask you to remember that. And as you have opportunity, as you fill your envelopes, write your check, if you would place them in the mail and send them to us here at Trinity, 2100 Westchester Avenue, we are checking our mailbox and would receive them then. It would mean much to us in the ongoing work of the church, and it would mean much to know that our service is complete. Now we began our service with singing, hearing the hymn of promise. It's such a wonderful hymn because it places the truth of the resurrection right in our lives. And so I would ask that you might think about joining in as we present this hymn again, the hymn of promise.
In the bulb there is a flower, in the seed an apple tree, in cocoons a hidden promise, butterflies will soon be free. In the cold and snow of winter there's a spring that waits to be unrevealed until its season, something God alone can see. There's a song in every silence, seeking word and melody. There's a dawn in every darkness, bringing hope to you and me. From the past will come the future, what it holds a mystery, unrevealed until its season, something God alone can see. end is our beginning, in our time infinity. In our doubt there is believing, in our life eternity. In our death a resurrection, at the last a victory. Unrevealed until its season, something God alone can see.
Presentation today, and I hope that it has been helpful to you. Please stay safe. Please look out for each other. Please keep one another in our prayers and all others in our world. Hear our benediction. Oh, but first, let me just share a word about next week. Next Sunday, April the 5th, will be Palm Sunday, a very special Sunday for us, and we will have palms here, and it's the first Sunday in the month, so we'll also be having Holy Communion. We will do that communion here at the church, and I would invite you at home, as you listen to the recording and watch the recording, to have some bread and a cup of juice there, that as we take communion here, you can join us taking communion at home. Take your bread, consecrated by the word of our prayer, and your cup, similarly consecrated, and share in that communion as we have it together here. Bring together the folks that are in your household, that are there at home, and share together. It will be a good Palm Sunday as we remember Jesus' entry into Jerusalem, but his very soon arrest, trial, and crucifixion. And now may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make God's face to shine upon you. May the Lord light up any darkness that's in your life. May the Lord bring life to any place of despair in your life. And may the Lord's love, grace, and mercy adorn our lives this day, tomorrow, and forever. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Peace be with you. Amen.
God be with you till we meet again. By his counsels guide uphold you. With his sheep securely fold you. God be with you till we meet again.
God be with you too.
we meet.